Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I think maybe in response to the gentlelady's comments who just spoke, one of the reasons why the American people maybe don't understand the gravity of the threat of the CCP and maybe prioritize green efforts is because this Congress is not showing leadership in highlighting the seriousness of this problem. And the truth of the matter is, Mr. Chairman, for the past 40 years, policymakers from both major political parties have made the critical mistake time and again of believing that engagement with China would induce the communist totalitarian government in Beijing to cooperate with the West on a wide range of policy challenges, implement reforms to open their economy to free trade and free markets, and usher in a new era of political freedoms and democratization. Trade, access to U.S. capital markets, and transfer of technology was supposed to lead to a convergence of Chinese and Western interests. But over and over again, the Chinese Communist Party failed to meet our expectations. And as we aided in the rise of China, economically and militarily, the CCP became more and more emboldened. U.S. leaders' engagement strategy often turned a blind eye to the CCP's human rights violations, economic malfeasance, malign foreign investment, theft of intellectual property, forced transfer of technology, expansionist aggression, build up of its nuclear capabilities, the People's Liberation Army, and its Blue Water Navy, which is now the largest in the world, and its many empty promises, as well as the CCP's deep commitment to a hostile communist ideology that drives this malign behavior. Over and over, we dismissed this behavior, whether it was the crackdown and slaughter of peaceful protesters in Tiananmen in 1989, China's admission into the WTO in 2000, which enriched the Chinese but failed to force China to conform its behavior to international norms of fair and reciprocal trade, its military buildup in the South China Sea, or China's most recent blatant violation of its international treaty on Hong Kong. The result of this accommodation and leniency has been a disaster. In his book, The 100-Year Marathon, China's Secret Strategy to Replace the United States as the World's Superpower, Michael Pillsbury draws on his decades of experience as a DOD, CIA, and State Department official who had engaged with the hardliners in Beijing. He documented how Chinese culture and literature highlights the role of deception and heroes using cunning to manipulate others, concealing true motives, misleading enemies, feigning weakness while hiding growing strength, and veiling true intentions until the very end. His conclusion is alarming, that China is well on its way to achieving its ultimate objective by 2049, the 100-year anniversary of the establishment of the People's Republic of China. But the ultimate wake-up call was last year when the CCP violated an international treaty and dismantled Hong Kong's civil liberties, continued its oppression of ethnic minorities, including Uyghurs and Tibetans, dramatically accelerated its military buildup, and conducted increasingly belligerent provocations on land, sea, and in cyberspace, violating other nations' sovereignty. And it's continuing and amplifying its debt trap diplomacy through its One Belt, One Road initiative. After months of briefings during the China Task Force with current and former top administration officials on both sides of the aisle, business executives, ambassadors, diplomats, members of the U.S.-China Economic and Security Commission, think tanks, and various other outside experts, I, along with the 14 other members of the China Task Force last Congress, representing 11 committees of the U.S. House, issued a report with 82 key findings and more than 400 forward-leaning recommendations across six categories of CCP-related challenges: ideological competition, supply chains, national security, technology, economics, and energy and competitiveness. After all this work, we concluded that the CCP, through its internal totalitarian and surveillance state repression, its predatory economic practices, and its increasingly aggressive military posture, with over 1.4 billion people and a GDP poised to overtake the size of the U.S. economy in just a few short years, represents the greatest existential national economic and security challenge in American history. And so, Mr. Chairman, this is why I'm disappointed that this legislation today does not take the China Task Force recommendations seriously, does not incorporate those recommendations. And so I would say it's one thing to try to reinvent the wheel, but this legislation doesn't even try to do that. It is an entirely different thing and wholly disregard an entire body of substantive and bipartisan policy work that would more effectively counter CCP aggression. So that is why I reluctantly oppose the Eagle Act, because it disregards the extensive work and bipartisan work of the China Task Force. And I do applaud the chairman and my Democrat colleagues for addressing the issue. I just wish that this legislation would take up this body of work, significant and substantive body of work that the China Task Force, under the leadership of the ranking member of this committee, engaged in extensively during the last Congress. With that, I yield back.